in an area that is called Vojvodina. It's actually not precise because it's the Serbian name of an area of southern Hungary which was independent when the Hungarian Revolution was quelled in 1848. And I felt it on my skin. If I would like to describe myself, I would say it's a bit pretentious that I'm a sort of Malti. I was a sort of Malti before I knew what Malti was. I attended a kindergarten where we sat around tables and spoke five languages. At the beginning, we didn't have a common denominator, but after a couple of months, we were able to communicate quite easily. And this brought me to the idea of communication between cultures, communication between languages, and this is practically the major of my research activities. Formerly, I'm a chartered architect, an art historian, but it's not the essence of my being. My essence is to connect influences, to connect cultures. This lecture is about an architect whose name is Béla Lajta, who was a Hungarian, or I would say Austro-Hungarian. I have to finish at 6:30.
Yes, the whole session with questions and
so
answers.
I will speak roughly an hour because I'm like a lecturing machine. This gentleman, I found many affinities with this architect of the turn of the century, I mean the 19th and 20th century. He was also a sort of Malti. He was a talented musician. He wanted to be an actor, but the family was a conservative Jewish family, and they considered art to be something, to say the least, luxurious. And then they told him, well, if you want to be a painter, we are not paying for your tuition fee. But if you could go to architecture, it would be a nice compromise. It is partly art, partly science, partly technology, and this is a way how he became an architect. He was a well-connected person. After finishing a technical university in Budapest, which was quite a good school at that time, he toured Europe. He spent a year in England, he spent a year in Germany, so he was a sort of antenna for all exciting events, trends of contemporary, actually, period Europe. Why did he come home? And this was an interesting issue. In Budapest, the Jewish community wanted to build the biggest synagogue in the world. Actually, the Dohain synagogue was at that time the biggest, it's still the second biggest in the world. But they had the wish to build a super temple for 5,000 worshippers, which is completely in odds with the Jewish heritage, with dialogue, with intimacy, with philosophy, whatever you name, it was against the mainstream. And it was a competition, and he won the second prize. And it was so important for him that he realized that Budapest was an exciting place, but in order to learn that, he had to go abroad and come home. He came from a very, very rich Jewish family who owned a department store, actually owned a tailor shop. Oh, thank you so much. for the upper classes of the Hungarian capital, and the family, you know, owning a building in the city of, in the center of Budapest of 3,000 square meters, around 1900, speaks about the richness of the family, material richness. He suffered the Jewish community. He was one of the very few Jewish architects who have had a sound Jewish identity, who attended the synagogue service, who was appointed to be not a caretaker, but a sort of coordinator of the Jewish cemeteries in Budapest. So it is an exemption, because basically Hungarian Jews at that period and even today are very assimilated. Not only that they eat pork with a great pleasure, but they they neglect high holidays, as today and tomorrow is the highest holiday, you know, for the Jews. So, and I'm here, you see. And it's, but he was a guy who found a sound middle way between Jewish and being Hungarian. The lecture today is about his humor. The idea is, however, not mine. I was lecturing about Lajta in many places. And at a conference in Jerusalem, a large conference which is called World Congress of Jewish Studies, a student stood up and said, "Well, you are talking about identity, you are talking about fantasy, whatever. It is humor. Try to name it." And I was very intimidated because humor is a difficult subject. Humor is related to philosophy, to psychology. How can I handle this? And then came the editor-in-chief of Ars Judaica, which is one of the most important journals in the field, and he said, "I'm commissioning from you a paper on Lajta and Jewish humor." And then this article appeared. It is here circling among you. But the editor-in-chief somehow acknowledged my fears, and he downgraded humor to wit, which is a more liberal term, and I'm not so much obliged to go deep into philosophy. But I will still do some incursions into philosophy, and I would state that there are three mainstays of my thinking. One is about architecture, logically it's about buildings. The other one is about humor. This is the most difficult one, and here I'm a complete amateur. And the third thing is the Jews who are producing this wit, where I'm not entirely an amateur. So I can see the relationship between architecture and Jews, architecture and theories of humor, and humor and Jews, which is a well-researched topic, how Jewish humor works. I mean, it's not my business to elaborate. So first, humor theories and architecture. Basically, there are four types of humor theories in the bibliography, going back well into the 18th century. First is the incongruity theory, represented by Kant, Kierkegaard, which states that humor is a response to ambiguity, logical impossibility, irrelevance, and inappropriateness. So it is something, two things, that doesn't really go together. But Jewish wit is much beyond that, because in that case, any mismatch would qualify to be humor. But humor has a message beyond this mismatch. The next package is, I'm less sympathetic towards Anglo-American philosophy and analytic philosophy. I'm more Hegelian, and I know that it's a shame nowadays, but nevertheless, the superiority theory, put forward by Thomas Hobbes. Humor arises from the sudden glory that we realize under our superiority over others. So how stupid they are. These are these politically incorrect jokes about Bosnians. I grew up in Yugoslavia, and the Bosnians were the ones, or the Ostfriesen in Germany, you know, who are really problematic in intellectual achievements. And this is the superiority theory that turns with the Jews into inferiority theory, because they lived in as a minority and they were considered to be inferior. And then they developed the double humor that they are, regarding the social position, inferior, but actually spiritually they pretend to be superior to the others. Well, let's not enter deep into these waters, particularly not tonight. The third theory is the relief theory, which is a psychological theory that says that humor serves a relief of repression, put forward mainly by Sigmund Freud, my favorite spiritual father, who discovered all these secrets of not only hysteria. Hysteria was just a pretext for him to dive into human soul very deeply. And the fourth group is the play theory, which is based on animal play, because we know that animals also tend to behave sometimes in a humorous way, and they are aware of the fact that they are playing. And then we have the levels of architecture, where I feel a bit more on my territory. Architecture could be divided into different levels. First is the volume, the whole building, this beautiful house. this house with its neighbors, so this is the level of volume, and the space which is inside, so this is the highest issue. And then you go down to the porch, you go to the portico, to the tower, whatever. So these are sub-volumes, sorry for my English. I learned it on the street, I never attended any language course. And then the visible structural elements like these purlins, rafters, and other constructive elements. And the lowest level is surface. Surface is when we touch. This is the contact between architecture and the material and space. Now the interesting thing is that you can make links between different types of humor and different elements of architecture. Now it sounds very philosophical and theoretical. You will see soon that it is quite easy to achieve. In order to be able to analyze architecture in terms of humor, we have to relate architecture to language, because humor theory works the best in language. There are some humor theories related to music. I heard lectures about the humor in Shostakovich's black humor in Stalinist times, Shostakovich's music, humor in Haydn's music. Haydn is Austro-Hungarian, it's not far from here, Rora, where he was active. This is also a type of humor, but in the framework of classicism, neoclassicism. So it's quite interesting to see. But in language, it's very easy to show, because it has the semantical triangle, it has the signifier, the signified, and the referent, so it really works smoothly. Now, I would have to show that architecture could be taken as a language. And then I will take a Renaissance palace in Florence, and saying that a language is characterized by two things. One thing is the set of elements, and the other thing is grammar that puts together these elements. Now, in these two levels, either the elements can expose some incongruity, or there could be an incongruity between the grammar and the elements. And this is the way how can you operationalize humor in architecture. Now, Jewish humor. On the left-hand side, we have general humor theories, so the four theories that I just explained. And we have elements of Jewish humor. Jewish humor in the post-exile period. Actually, we don't really know the Jewish humor in the period of Jewish statehood until 70, Common Era, because it wasn't a topic. It's interesting that the Jews started considering themselves Jewish only when they encountered the others, basically when they were in slavery. Slavery in Babylonia, slavery under the Romans, and so on and so forth, slaveries that later changed into a more politically correct relationship, but still some tensions between this minority and the majority persisted all over 4,000 years of Jewish history. So one of the most important elements of Jewish humors is challenging the authority. Challenging the strong, as they were weak, military, politically, whatever you want, they were weak, and challenging the system was a way to relieve themselves. You see, this count, this feudal lord, is very powerful, but he's actually stupid. So this challenging the authority, which is called chutzpah in Yiddish and chutzpah in Hebrew, challenging, it's a sort of impudence, but this impudence is not a sake of itself, it is challenging authorities. Now it goes so far that then they are challenging not only Gentile authorities, but their own authorities, which is a very interesting proposition, that you challenge your own system and your own existence. All it is in this challenging authority and identity. This is the reason that in cabarets you had always what is today fashionably called gender bending. In the 19th century, cabarets in the Király utca in Budapest, which was the most important, it was the Budapest Broadway, to say. Later became the Nagymászi utca, but it was never so vivid as Király utca or Königsegg, King Street. They had this cabaret system in which they used gender bending. They used it that men played the role of women, and they were not transsexuals. It was against the system. because the gender division is also part of the big hierarchy. This is the reason that in dictatorships this is not allowed. Anything that goes between is challenging the system. The second item is anti-terrorism. In the case of Hungary, it is against the 19th century Hungarian pathetic nationalism with these pathetic statues of this and that. They might have been quite short and stocky, but they got, you know, a huge statue with slender and muscles and so on and so forth. So challenging anti-heroism, challenging heroism, and anti-heroism is also part of this business. The third item is the crooked mirror. A crooked mirror which is making a caricature of everyone, not only the Gentiles, of course not. All of the Kirayot Sakabari was against the Jews who thought that they got emancipated and now they are equal with the others. Of course they were not. It was just a formal emancipation, financial emancipation, even financial dominance, if you like. But they were not equal. And this crooked mirror was a journal called Bosch Semyanko, which translates to Johnny the Pepper. The pepper, which is a very small, you know, a spice, but it's terribly strong. It destroys you. And this was this crooked mirror. Item four is self-parody. So they were mocking themselves. They were mocking Jewish profiles, you see? The nose. I don't want to be a racist, particularly not against myself, but this is this idea of self-parody with this caricature of Jews, done by the Jews themselves, much better than the Nazis did later. The Nazis were really amateurs. They had a couple of, you know, templates, and they were playing with that, the rich Jew, the fat Jew, the clumsy Jew, the Jew with platfuss, you know, I mean, this was a notion that, masochistic mask. There is a psychological phenomenon. It was put forward recently, Martin Grotian, a theoretician of humor, that the Jews torture themselves to show that they can bear more than the others impose on them. So this is masochistic mask. Double-edged laughter. It is Marie Glück who elaborated. She is a fantastic, she's an American teacher of sociology, I guess, or social history, who emphasized this double-edged laughter. But on the one hand, you ridicule the other, but at the same time, you ridicule yourself. So this is this issue. And the last issue is replacing reality principle with individual fantasy, creativity, including sexual fantasies. So this is, of course, Kössler, Bergson, and the most important is my friend Sigmund Freud. Now we have these links that connect the incongruity theory with challenging authority, with anti-heroism and crooked mirror. You have the superiority-inferiority theory that corresponds with the self-parody, mocking the Jewish features. You have the relief theory, which is related to the masochistic mask, and so on and so forth. Now, let me tell you a couple of sentences about this minority. They were not exactly very tiny minority, roughly 1/4 of the Budapest citizens were Jewish. So they were very strong. In average in Hungary it was 5%, and in the northeast it went up to 40% in these backward areas of what is today Ukraine. Jews appeared first on the territory of Hungary in the 2nd century in the Roman Empire. And they disappeared with the Romans and reappeared in the high medieval period. Hungarian kings were eager to have them for banking, you know, all these skills that they were supposed to be familiar with. With the liberation of Hungary from the Turks, I hope there are no more Turks. No Turks here. I had to say Ottoman Empire. Sorry for being politically incorrect in such a brilliant multicultural place like this. Jews were also slaughtered together with the Muslims because they were considered collaborators of the Muslims. Mm-hmm. It's true that they spoke, they always speak a lot of languages. They spoke Turkish, they spoke Arabic, and they traded between Vienna and Cairo and whatever you want. So they were slaughtered. And the third wave of, particularly in Buddha, it was, and there is a nice piece how one single family survived, because this family even spoke Czech. And the soldiers who were about to kill them were just Czechs. And then they said that you would be rewarded afterwards because we are Czechs, we are speakers of the same language. So it's one single family that survived. After the Ottoman Empire, the third wave came with modernization to Hungary. These are again the feudal lords who needed the services of the Jews, basically to foster trade and commerce. And later on, they were an important agent in the project of Magyarization. You know that Hungarians were a minority in their own country until the end of the 19th century. They made a gentleman's agreement with the Jews that if they declare themselves, it was, I think, in Kossuth's period, I don't precisely know who made this agreement, but it was the agreement between the head of the Jewish communities and the Hungarian National Party, that if they declare themselves Hungarian, then 48 will become 53, and the Hungarian speakers will constitute a majority in the Hungarian kingdom. So this was really a key role the Jews played first in a political sphere, and then it spread to other spheres. And in the 1840s, they already got a certain kind of free movement. They could own property, which was quite early in Europe, particularly in the context of, I don't like the expression Eastern Europe, but it was. And in 67, with the Ausgleich, with the Austro-Hungarian Compromise, they got full civil rights that lasted until 1920, when the numerus clausus appeared, and these civil rights were taken away, and we know the history. The general opinion about the Jews was quite divided. Here we have Ferenc Deák, a nemzet bölcse, the wise of the nation. Der Weise des Vaterlandes, it sounds better in German. I was invited to Vienna University, so part of this business is in German. He said that Jews are like salt. You need a bit of it in all the meals, but if it's too much, it spoils the joy. And this is very much, you know, a politically incorrect statement, particularly from a minister of justice. But that was it. And this is the situation. Too much salt. Some opinions around 1900. It was Karl Lieger, Vienna's mayor, who said that I'm the one, he named Budapest Judapest, because of this strong cultural presence. Budapest is Judapest. And then he had also Jewish friends. He was not a great friend of the Jews, particularly not of anyway. And he said, I'm going to decide who is a Jew, because he had Jewish friends. And it applied to very many politicians. Horthy was not a great friend of the Jews, but he had a lot of Jewish friends. So this is this double issue, you know, you don't like a minority, but you have friends among them. Yeah. And then comes Károly Kósh, the architect, German-born, who was born Karl Kósh. And he was lamenting around 1900 that 99% of our Hungarian architects are of foreign origins. And it was true. In the 19th century, Hungarian architects were Germans, and the Jews were admitted to the university. And when they were admitted to the university, then in Budapest around 1900, two-thirds of the architects' offices were run by the Jews. It doesn't mean that all the draftsmen were Jewish, but the owner was. And then it is the nephew, Jan Lechner Kismarty, of Eden Lechner, who was the creator of Hungarian Anu, I will speak about it tomorrow, who uttered a politically highly incorrect sentence. The modern style of Hungarian architecture is Jewish-like, Zsidós. Not Zsidó, Jewish, but Jewish-like. It was difficult to translate to German and to English, but this is the point. Now let me linger a bit on this sword. The families. The family of Manfred Weiss, who was the owner of the chapel Steel Mill. It was his brother, his children, and his beautiful, beautiful gravestone in the cemetery of Salgótarjoni Street in Budapest. Baron Hatvani Deutsch, he owned the literary journal Nyugat, which was the hub of Hungarian modern literature. Of course, he was arbitrary, and he liked some writers, and some otherwise he disliked, and these disliked ones had little chance to succeed, at least in these circles. This is Simon Kornfeld, who was a Czech-born Jew. He was the most important banker of Hungary, who learned Hungarian language. And his hobby was to translate literature to Hungarian and from Hungarian. And then you have a lot of industrialists, and it trickles down to Jewish middle classes, this honest, upward mobile Bürgertum, and these are Bürgertum from the little towns. I took it on purpose, not Budapest, which is a showcase of the country. They were photographing themselves with the servants, it's interesting. And this is an Orthodox couple in Budapest, and this is the countryside. This is a multicultural orchestra. It wasn't named multicultural, but it is. These were Jewish klezmers, these were gypsies and Ukrainian peasants in the southeast of Hungary. And this is more or less the milieu, this rural environment, and taking photographs was a big, big issue. So you see all these people who are working in the mill are posing in front of the mill. The village where on the main street you have a kosher restaurant, another village with the marketplace, and here you have, I particularly like this photograph, a religious Jew who takes his chicken to the ritual slaughter on Shabbat, before Shabbat, in due time, Friday midday, and then it is slaughtered. You see how amateur, no machinery, nothing, it's just on the middle of the courtyard, they are cutting the throat, and it's not only throat cutting, they are examining the guts, whether this animal was healthy or not. As I told you, first Jews were active in the economy, industry, and slowly they entered literature and they entered the arts. Here we have a sitting and kneeling around this piano, we have Georg Lukács, the philosopher, who is not very popular nowadays because he was a bit too much to the left, but nevertheless, he was the only one besides Benedetto Croce who was able to connect Marxism and aesthetics, which is quite a heroistic and futile attempt. And then you have Béla Balázs near the piano, who was the librettist of Béla Bartók. They created the Blue Bards castle, which is an absolute masterpiece. Here you have Jászi Oszkár, these are the very famous actors. The Pestelloid. The Pestelloid was the most important news channel in the 19th century. Without all this gadgetry, they were able to form the public opinion of period Pest and partly also period Buda. It was the German-speaking newspaper that was by and large owned and edited by liberal Jews. And here you have Molnár Ferenc and Heltai, the writer of Palutcai Fiúk. Sorry, I didn't read it in English. How do you say it in English? Palutcai Fiúk. Oh, thank you so much. Jews and Modernism, here we have Hugo Feigelsberg, who was the editor of the New Guard. Here you have József Kiss, who was a poet, who was a Hungarian modernist, but he was also a Jew, quite an interesting proposition. Here you have the most famous Hungarian Jewish composer in the 19th century, Karl Goldmark. And it has been recorded, this is the Queen of Sheba, a very mediocre piece of music in the 19th century, but it was so spectacular that it was the most played stuff in the State Opera of Vienna until the Anschluss. So it was not up to Tristan und Isolde and the Ring, but it was very popular. Jewish humor. It is the Jewish satirical Johnny the Pepper and the editor-in-chief and an owner, Adolf Ágai. And here you have this little Johnny Pepper, which is a cloned monstrous animal, and the caricatures. This caricature is from the period, I don't have my pointer on the blackboard, on the screen. Never mind, on the right-hand side, this pretty lady is Mother Hungary. And thank you so much. And this is in the period of the blood libel of Tisza Eszlár. And these Jews, you see the Jewish caricature, big head and degenerated and legs and the little ass, you know, the Jewish caricature. They are running, it's another Jew, running to Mother Hungaria, for being protected from all this anti-Semitic hysteria. Now we came to a very actual political topic, migration. And you can see there was no barbed wire at that time, it was an invention of late 19th century. This is mid-19th century, actually 60s and 70s. Határőrség, border police, you see in this, they are caricatured, they are actually in this stussy hat, like Austrians, you know. I mean, and these Jews, you know, in this bag, and the guy says, let us leave this country. There are too many Jews and they are too hostile towards us. You know, they're just turning away with their huge noses. There are some figures of this satirical Salomon Seifensteiner, who was a grocer in the Kiraritza, with all these racial features, and a bomb on which the SOS is with a six-pointed star. And this is, and of course the name is Salomon, he's still a religious Jew. And Seifensteiner, Seife is a soap and Stein is a stone. So who sells, you know, soap like stone, but with huge gestures, and he's just smoking his pipe. This guy is a shrewd guy, you see big Jewish nose and his shrewd eyes. He's Itzik Spitzig, the Budapest journalist. And this is from the highest echelons of the society, W.M. Börsevici. It's a banker, you know, it's obviously, he is a banker, a Jewish banker, and this gesture. He still has these gestures of the small Jew from the Kiraitza, you know, this, aha, kiss die Hand, gnädige Frau, and all this goes with that. But he has all the outfit of a rich man. And here is the most important figure, the Orthodox rabbi, who is against all this assimilation, all this show-off, because he said, you will pay for that. And he was right. And his name is Reb Menahem Zitzesmeister. Zitzit is this textile that is that hangs from the trouser of religious Jews, and Beisen means biting, so he's the guy who is very religious and bites the tzitzis. The newly ennobled Jewish baron, the lady says, oh dear David, what's the problem with you? Why you scratch your hand? Oh Zilikam, Angelum, my angel, I feel how my blood is becoming blue. Now we came to architecture, and I still have 20 minutes left. This is the Institute for Blind of the Jewish community of Pest, and the architect is, of course, Béla Lajta. The building is a caricature. You know, Budapest is the city of freestyle, neo-Renaissance, the Andrássy út, Rákóczi út. It is all conveying the message the Jews are the Medicis and Sforzas of the Gründerzeit, which is a very problematic proposition, but this is the message. Now he goes against it and applies a national romantic architectural style, which is on one hand a bit Finnish, which was very en vogue at that period. On the other hand, it's a bit Transylvanian with this touch of Dracula and of course Romanticism. Now let's see how it translates to architectural elements. I spoke about issue one, the whole building, the volumes and spaces, it is blue. Level two, sub-volumes and structural elements. And level three is the surface material and decoration. Now the first joke is really a big joke. You have the main entrance, which is a parabolic arch, very modern at that period. It is 1906-7-8. Particularly in Finland, Saarinen and all these guys are using this parabolic arch because the parabolas is a very new structure made of concrete, but it's unsellable in Hungary. So he names it as Bogia Eve, related to Hungarian landscape and agriculture. This is the main entrance. But the other entrance, the entrance to the gym, is, while this is massive, made of brick and concrete, this is a very fragile, made of thin columns and a metal sheet, which imitates the hupe, the kupa, the Jewish wedding tent. So you will see the details of this wedding tent. The wedding tent is basically, you know, Jews are a nomadic people from the desert, and all these habits and festivals are actually stemming from the desert. So in the desert you don't have a synagogue, you don't have anything. So you, when it's really a push of time that a wedding should be carried out because of certain reasons, then they have a portable synagogue, so to say. They have the chuppa, which is made of four rods, timber rods, and the textile. And now you have the two rods, and the rods are made of metal, of course it's a modern material, and has a capital, but the capital has a menorah, which is a statehood symbol of Israel, but not only that, it has also a peacock, something which is a Hungarian symbol. Now, the point is that you can read the whole composition that the menorah is the peacock's tail, with which the peacock wants to impress, you know, when he is in action, he makes his tail huge. Now, see what's going on. What is carrying the load? Not the peacock, but the tail. So it says, we are carrying the load. The menorah is carrying the load, which is a very good statement. Now you have the details, the level of details, the tulip, the Hungarian national and the Turkish national and so forth, so on and so forth, national symbol. And from this menorah, actually it is not a menorah, it's a Hanukkah. It has eight branches plus the Shames, the ninth candle, and it's a sort of clone, which ridicules this so-called symbiosis of Hungarians and Jews, because it was, now we speak about the golden age when they lived the symbiosis, they appreciated each other, no, they were fighting each other, you know, it was really, if you read the newspapers, and all this is in the entrance to let you know that where are you entering right now. Now you have the Seglar's Gate, a Hungarian, very Hungarian, and Transylvania is the untouched Hungarian motherland that was not influenced by the Austrians, by the Turks, whomever you like. And then he translates this into metal and puts a live tree, a sort of menorah, on the top. And of course it is then flanked by some Art Nouveau decoration, also Finnish national romanticism with a squirrel because the squirrel is not really a Hungarian animal. You don't have, in the pusta is not populated with squirrels, so it is not part of our meat. And probably the strongest statement is this statement, where you have a menorah created with a shepherd's carving, and in front of it you have a deer. And my interpretation was that it is the holy deer, it is the Chola Sarvash. Then I was heavily attacked that this is a Jewish tribal symbol. It's true that it's the tribal symbol of a Tzvi, but there are no other tribal symbols of this building, so it is not that, because in the next building there will be complete Jewish tribal symbols. And then you have this interesting situation when these peacocks are pecking the live tree and the menorah, and the same applies for the squirrels, that this building is finished and Hungarian. The next building is 2 years later, when architecture moves away from national romanticism, at least in Lajta's opus, and starts playing with proto-modern classicism, and the inside is Wiener Werkstätte. It's important that he was very multicultural. Multicultural in the sense of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, not in terms of non-European cultures. He was pretty much a European. Now you have a building that is, at least to say, odd. Here you have this Transylvanian folklore, Transylvanian vernacular architecture with these parabolic arches, and here you have in the central projection something absolutely odd. And then you said the analysis again, the levels. And now let me analyze. There are different statements and the huge incongruity. This speaks about national romanticism, Hungarian, Transylvanian, national, mystic, mythical heritage on the both side projections. In the central projection, it is modernist, no decoration. See this part. It is almost Adolf Loos. Rational, but funny in a way. It is funny because here you have a pediment. I put apart this part of the building, the street facade. And you have neoclassicism, so it is really a pastiche, it is more, it's a collage of different architectural statements, each of them in certain kind of incongruity, which has a message. So it's not just incongruity, it has a message, so it can be termed as humor. So here you have national romantic, in the center projection, this is a stone-cladded part with the classical rational, and on the upper side, you realize that it is all Judaic, it's Jewish. This is the palm tree, and this is the lulav, the palm tree that serves for the a feast of tents, Sukkot. And on the top there is a Moses figure. A Moses figure that even shows a certain gender bending. It is in contrapost. It's the first thing that it is placed in a niche, like a saint. In a very baroque manner. And then he is caressing his beard. It's not really, you know. And he has some femininity, which goes to Lillian, actually. It is a certain application of Lillian, his illustrations. But definitely it is a joke, because Jews are not supposed to have visual representation, particularly not a statue. Two-dimensional, a caricature, it's still allowed because you can't worship. The very moment that it becomes a statue, it is a saint and you can worship it. So in a way, he ridicules the Jewish reluctance, visual reluctance, on the other hand, ridicules assimilation, that this Moses is like a saint in his contrapposto, in his gesture, in his dress is also very much problematic. Now you have the idea of the pilaster. And here you have the palm tree, which doesn't touch the string course. It's a very important statement. So this is rid of its function, because the function is, it is not touching, it's not a static function anymore. But it recalls the Greek temple where the column touches the architrave and carries the load of the architrave and the pediment. Here it is just, you know, decoration like my beard. So it is a non-tectonic and Jewish. Here you have the idea of the lunette of Palazzo Farnese, which is made of two palm leaves, reference to to the Sukkot. And then the tribal symbols. We have here the symbol of the tribe of Judah, Tzvi, Noah's Ark, the live tree menorah. We have the snake that made all this trouble upon us, you know, with Eve. And the last thing, and probably the most important thing, was the first Jewish medieval flag that was created under the reign of King Matthias Corvinus, and his finance minister wasn't called like that, he was a treasurer. Jakob Mendel was allowed to ride a horse with this flag in front of the king and the queen. At the same time, you have the Öcsényi Bíborvég, motif of Hungarian folklore. So it is intermittently Öcsényi Bíborvég, biblical symbols, again Öcsényi Bíborvég. It's a sort of dobos torta or moussaka with all this. Yes, I skipped my lunch. Municipal trade school in Pest, which is really a die-hard modernist building with this, I would say, curtain wall, to use a modern term. It's a 1909 project, and he altered until the execution, which was 1912. But on the details, you have two stone plates, which is a reference to the Luchot, to Moses' plates. There is a clear reference, the menorah. And you have this David star, which is like a pusedli, a kusel, this cake. And here you have the menorah, the Luchot, and all this decoration. And the most, the strongest statement is this steam engine that has its pivot covered with a six-pointed star. Saying very humbly on the Jewish side that we are pivotal to this economy because it's an economy, it is a business school. And actually it refers to the construction of the railways in Austria-Hungary that were first financed by the Rothschilds and the Pereiras, Ashkenazic and the Sephardi family from Vienna. And then they sold it to the state, quite a good business. Not the way around. You have the ceiling of this school, which has this decoration, which is pretty complex. First, you have the Hungarian, the Öcsényi Bíborvég, which is not entirely Hungarian; it's also Turkish. These were these connections between Hungarians and Turks before coming to this area, and after much less because the Turks were seen as enemies. Then it is framed with the menorah, yeah. And it is put into a framework of the Wiener Werkstätte. So it is a very multi-layered, and all of them are in contradiction. It's all incongruity if you go into this problem deeper. And by the end of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, Lajta, a fantastic innovator, abandoned by and large Art Nouveau, abandoned by and large Wiener Werkstätte, and embarked on the project of modernism. Modernism that doesn't really care for decoration. Later period, it bans decoration. Ornament und Verbrechen, Adolf Loos published his pamphlet actually in 11, when this building was not yet built. And you see, it is a Jewish school. So, first of all, it has an entrance projection, which is completely oriental. And then it has a modernist part in this long window. This is the synagogue, actually. And the strongest statement is the lobby, where you have, it's already the period of reinforced concrete. And the reinforced concrete asks for equal spans. This is the way that you rationally distribute the load. But not here. It is mimicking the synagogue, the nine-base synagogue, and it has a constructive reason, but it's not also construction. It is the point that Jews wanted to define this internal space as a special space where the scripture is being read, so it should be framed, and then this spatial template is transferred to a Jewish school. Further jokes. Nothing is said for Lajta. It is a sort of Solomon's temple, but it is a cabaret theater, Parisiana. Cabaret theater is a mild expression in Hungarian, you call it mulatto. A place where you entertainment including frivolity and some sort of slight prostitution. And then it is in the frame of Solomon's temple with two columns, the Yahin and Boaz, and this frieze on the top of it. And this building was of course constructed, but the city requested that these two columns should be removed because the joke was too explicit. And then he went to the cemetery and made experiments for over 10 years to promote Solomon's temple. Actually, it's not the first temple, it's the last, the third, Herod's temple, with the two columns. The proportions are actually the proportions of Herod's temple and not Solomon's temple. And he didn't find any customer for such a grave until the proper family showed up, who had no idea about Jewish history, nothing, and they were very happy to have the two columns, but topped with lions, because they considered themselves very strong, and because the Solomon's temple didn't have the lion, because it would have been a political problem that then is the tribe of Judah, so it's really... remaining in the framework of funeral art, still 5 minutes left, this is the tomb of the family Schmidl. Mr. Schmidl was a banker, and he was in the on the board of the Postal Saving Bank of Pest, which ends with this motif. So it was by the end of the 19th century, Jewish graves ceased to be modest signs of the deceased and became a show-off. So it was quite normal to have an association, a reference to the bank that he was serving. Then you have a six-pointed star, so he was a Jewish guy who was on the board. But this David star is made of Hungarian honey cakes in the shape of heart. So it is a sort of macho folklore. Tomorrow I will analyze how Jews deployed Hungarian folklore and turned into an idiom, but it's a more academic lecture with a very boring thoughts. And then you have this is a collage. There was a myth that Lechner, the father of Hungarian Anubo, was co-authoring with Lajta. Then I can't believe Lechner was a German-born Hungarian, Austro-German-born Hungarian, a very serious guy with huge talent. He wouldn't enter such a problematic design. Here you have the mud of the Levites, as you know, for flowers that are growing out. A lot of jokes. Here you have the willow tree framed as the door, and it is at the same time Moses' tablets of the law, which are the willow. A sorrow, you know, what a misery that these tablets caused us. And then you have the mosaic, which is Art Nouveau and Byzantine, and the cherub wings, you like chicken wings here, you know, and so on and so forth. Now, again, with the curse of Reb Menachem Tzitzes Beiser, I would like to summarize my ideas. The common denominator between architecture, Lajta, and the Jewish humor is challenging the system, duality of discourses, levels of architecture, volume, sub-volume, space, surface, structure, mocking assimilation, the honey cake shaped David star, mocking Christianity and Judaism, as well as Hungarian nationalism, Moses as a saint, peacock with the menorah tail. Self-mocking of the Jews, the cabaret takes the form of Solomon's temple. What an impudence. Funeral monument as Solomon's temple, which is a sort of, let's say, okay. And then the most important statement is the self-mocking architecture as a genre, palm tree pilaster, something that shows up as a pilaster, but it remains atectonic. Thank you, that was it.